for the best car, SUV, or truck, guess what? You're in luck. Frontier Motors is down the street. Got the best deals that can't be beat. Don't overpay, come in today. Doing business the old-fashioned way. Frontier, we got the right price. Frontier, we'll treat you mighty nice. Frontier Motors, low overhead country.
Yes, indeed. And we are pleased to have one of the owners of that fine establishment with us today, ready, willing, and certainly more than able to take any phone inquiries from you. You might want to call to get a value of a car or a truck or an SUV that you're thinking of buying or selling or trading in. Or you might want to call and direct a question at the special guest that Ivan Streckel has brought with him today. Good morning, sir.
Hey, Don, thanks for the introduction. I appreciate it. This, again, is a double format, which means that not only are we live on 1370 AM radio, and this is a call-in show, by the way, which the phone number is 437-1620. We're also videotaping this for our Blab customers to hopefully be seen around the world. And we've been doing the show on Blab for almost 19 years, and I'm getting a little bit bored because this is a car show. So today we decided to switch it up a little bit, and I've brought Bruce Baldwin, the president of the Blue Wahoos, with us to talk baseball instead of cars. Now, Bruce can talk cars because he is a car nut. Bruce has also a customer of Frontier Motors.
But I'm sorry to interrupt you and tell you that the actual phone number is 478-3116.
That's what I said, 478-3116.
Yeah, I think 1620 might be a different phone number.
Yeah, you shouldn't be saying that on
the
air.
That's correct, yeah. 478-3116.
Pretty funny. 478-3116.
You know what you're doing?
I'm just starting out. It's 19 years ago. So we have invited Bruce to talk a little bit baseball with us. And by the way, if you do have a question on a car, because this is a car dealership show, this is Frontier Motors, and if you want to join us, you can talk about cars. But Bruce, I got this off the internet today, and I know that we've talked for a couple of months, but one thing I didn't know is that the Southern League of Professional Baseball Clubs has announced that Pensacola Blue Wahoos president Bruce Baldwin is the 2012 Jimmy Bragan Executive of the Year. That's pretty damn good. 2012. Now, this is 2015. It's 3 years ago.
Yeah, but I'm just now getting the award. That's what I'm saying. Thank you.
This is the second league. This is the second Southern League Executive of the Year award for Bruce, who was also honored while serving as general manager of the Greenville Braves in 84. That year, he was recognized by the Sporting News as Baseball Executive of the Year, entering the 2012 season as the first president in Pensacola Blue Wahoos history. Bruce oversaw the day-to-day operations of the club in the Southern League, and with an attendance of 320, and that was that a one-year record, or have you suppressed that over the couple of years?
Well, so far that's a one-year record. We did, I think it was about 305 on year two, and then we did 311 last year, I believe it was.
It's really interesting because the first year...
Oh, and by the way, thank you for inviting me here.
Yeah, you're welcome. It's very interesting because the first year, everybody thought it was a fluke. They talked about it, and some naysayers about the stadium. I was always for the stadium. I wanted it. Of course, we moved downtown in that time frame, so this was, to me, the best thing that ever happened to Pensacola. But I do remember talking to some people that said this is going to be short-lived. The first year is going to be a good year, and it's going to take a dive after that, and that just hasn't been the case.
No, it has not. And thanks for bringing that up, because that's very important to us. What we try to create is really two elements, economic development and then quality of life issues and stuff. We've already sold over 200,000 tickets for this year already.
What?
Yeah, oh yeah. And then we're going to hit the 1 millionth fan sometime in May.
Do they get a little prize?
They get a picture of you.
Oh. Come on, 1 million? They got to do something else. We'll give them one of our famous.
See what happens.
It's got to be. I'm sure you guys. Well, with the Blue Wahoos, there's always something going on. You guys make it really fun and exciting. It's one thing I got to say. When you go, I had some people here from out of town from Wisconsin. Our relatives came down last year, and they said they go to the Milwaukee Braves up there or the Brewers.
Brewers.
That's right. They moved to Atlanta. It tells you how long I've been out of Milwaukee.
30 years ago.
Yeah, I've been out of Milwaukee 25 years. I should know that. I've gone to a lot of Brewers games, but they go to the Brewers, and they said, this was a better stadium and more fun than they have watching the Brewers, which that's a pretty good compliment.
Thank you very much. We take a great deal of pride of how we present our product. The last 2 years, there's a national publication that ranks all of the sports facilities in the United States, whether it be football, basketball, baseball, whatever it might be. We have not only finished first in all of baseball, but we have finished 11th and then 12th last year in the entire United States. And it's not just about the facility. It's about the quality of the facility, certainly the ambiance, and it's really a lot about the employees that work there. All are we've got about 400 folks that work with us. Wow. And then the food. We take a great deal of pride in our food. We're always trying to get very creative with that. Mm-hmm. We've won some awards because of the food and stuff. And so we just like to present a product. Whether you're there as a business person to just escape for a few hours, or if you're taking a client there, or if it's a family opportunity or a date night, whatever it might be, I think that we do a pretty good job of catering to all of that. And then we work very hard to kind of keep it clean, neat. And every year we try to do something a little bit different. When you walk in, and you'll notice something that will go, oh, that's different from last year.
Yeah, and that, and unfortunately, I was out of town when you guys had the opener, and the opener, was the opener sold out?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I would imagine it was. So, unfortunately, I missed that, and I guess they won that one, right? Let's not talk about that. But one of the things that I really like,
I bought for me, I'm coming in.
The food at the stadium is phenomenal.
Thank you.
Really don't have to go to the restaurant. I'm especially a fan of that great big footlong they have, that all the way out on the outfield. They got special fat hot dogs that are better than the Brewer Plumpers that they're famous for in Milwaukee area.
Well, that's because you can't say it very well. So ours are better.
they are better. Now, I noticed also, Bruce, that before you joined the Wahoos, you did a stint with the Braves for like 28 years. What was your capacity with the
Braves? I started at the very bottom. My first assignment with Atlanta was Pulaski, Virginia, which is a little rural community in Southwest Virginia, population around 10,000 or so. And I was still under contract to a school district in Eugene, Oregon. And so my job to go out there was to create a baseball stadium, a baseball environment for a first-time ever place. And I took an old high school stadium and we turned it into a professional place. And it has remarkable memories of my short time in Pulaski. I still get a few Christmas cards from people from there. 20 plus years ago, and that was a fun place. And then from there, my contract with school district was up. Atlanta offered me a full-time position, so I drove cross-country again. I went to Savannah, Georgia. I closed that one down, built a new stadium in Greenville, South Carolina, was there. Then moved on to Richmond, Virginia, did that stadium, or part of that stadium, and was there for a long time. And then we closed that one down 23 years later, and then moved it to Metro Atlanta and built a ballpark in Gwinnett County. But throughout all that time, I was the GM of all of those ball clubs, was the AAA GM for a long time. And then I also was the executive director of the minor leagues. I ran all the teams. And then I just kind of fell into building stadiums, and I did six of them.
So. Wow. Were you instrumental in the Wahoo Stadium, or was it already there when you came on board?
No, I was part of that. You know, there was a really big collaborative effort that included myself and Jonathan Griffith, certainly Quint, mm-hmm. Architects and builders and designers and Mayor Hayward, and it was a really big collaborative effort. Even Brian Spencer, city councilman. So,
and Brian's a customer of ours too.
I understand he bought a car recently I might have known about.
He bought two cars. Matter of fact, he bought the same type of car that Bruce bought. He bought a BMW. So we do appreciate all of the councilman's business at Frontier Motors. This is the Frontier Motor Show. So our ulterior motive is to get people excited.
Notice how I led into that.
I like
you?
That. Yeah. Our ulterior motive is to get people excited about coming to the stadium. And also, because the stadium is so affordable, they might have extra money in their budget to be able
to buy
a car from Frontier Motors. I was looking the other day, Bruce, because I'm a season ticket holder. We have four tickets for Frontier Motors that if I don't use them myself, we give them to our employees to use, and they're always being used. And I think if I remember right, I just got the bill the other day, and I think it was about a little bit over $400 for a season ticket.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, you go to, I was listening to the other radio station this morning. They went to Jackson's last night for supper, and it's very easy to spend $400 at a place like Jackson's for supper if you've got five or six people. And here you've
got Jackson's is a great place.
It is. I love Jackson's. But it's interesting that one night at Jackson's equals a whole year at the stadium. And that's what I'm getting at, is I think that bang for your buck is great entertainment. And it doesn't mean you have to stay for the whole game. But if you get there, especially if you live downtown like I do, I'll walk over, I'll take my bicycle to the stadium, and I'll stay till the seventh or eighth inning, and I'll watch the rest of it from home because I'm fortunate enough to have a condo downtown, so I can watch. I can get my binoculars out. You could. You could. If they wouldn't have put that stupid black shield. What is that shield for anyway?
It's called a batter's eye.
See, that's what I know about.
So you live at Port Royal.
I live across from Port Royal. I live in the ones that by Jocko's there, the bigger ones, yep. Which up way high. So with my binoculars, I can see the new scoreboard you put up.
Now, you're going to go back to these places that you keep name-dropping and charge them something?
I should. But you didn't have that scoreboard initially when you open up. That scoreboard.
Yeah, we did.
It was always there?
Yep.
Okay, for some reason I couldn't see it, but now I can see
thing
it.
The thing in dead center field is called a batter's eye. When you throw a white baseball into a glove to a catcher that has a white uniform on with a batter that has some degree of white in it, the ball gets lost. So in order to help the batter a little bit to see the ball better, just help the catcher see the ball better and everybody, it's called a batter's eye. If you look at every baseball stadium in the country, there is some type of batter's eye in center field. Yankee Stadium, old Yankee Stadium, it was all seats, but what they did was they covered it with a tarp. And so that batter's eye really is more of a safety precaution than anything else.
I don't like it. Can you take it down?
No.
Because I can't see.
I don't like
I can't
car.
See. Right.
I don't like car, but can you take it back?
No.
Okay. Well,
we're even.
And let me tell you an interesting thing about your season tickets. We have a program called Ticket Share. And what that means basically is that you can put your tickets on sale online, and then if they are sold at the value that you paid for them, then you get that value as a credit to your account. So let's just easy math, $400 season tickets, you have a bank from the previous year of $100, we take $100 off.
Oh, that's interesting, which is really much better than if you can't make it and the tickets go to waste.
That's right.
And that's something I believe you do on the internet, right? You can get
that's right.
Right. In.
And you can also email those tickets out to your friends and stuff
you can?
Like that. Yep.
Yeah. Well, I'm still the old guy. I actually have real tickets. You know, I know you guys went to electronic or you went
to a
card or something like
we
that, did. Which you guys are like in the new way of doing business. I still like my tickets in my hand. I don't know why I get.
You have a push button in your car to start your engine?
I still have a BlackBerry. No, I'm just kidding. No, I'm just kidding.
Oh, that's the path. He's.
What's he going to get into once he graduates?
Well,
what kind of job can he get with that kind
he's
of a degree?
He's fluent in three languages.
Really?
And he didn't get that from me. I have a hard time with English and Pig Latin. But he got an internship this past summer with the Kansas City Royals in the Dominican Republic, where 90% of his day was speaking Spanish, and he taught classes to the young Spanish players or Latin players, and simple things like teaching them about checkbooks and airports and how you do that, and then he also worked with an accredited instructor and helped her with the the CDs that you can buy, you see advertised. The name escapes me right now, but. And then he did a lot of work as far on the player side with Kansas City. So his goal is to get in on the player development side of a major league organization. Now, he just got rehired again by Kansas City to go back again this summer, and it was just great. They're a wonderful group of people, a super organization, and so he's excited about that. So that was what he did. For me, it was just kind of hanging out and being around and knowing people. And said, this is really what I want to do. I coach football and tiddlywinks and all that neat stuff because I love doing that and I love being with kids. But I just, there was something else in it because I thought the Parks and Rec thing was a dead end. And I'm not being disrespectful because it is so different today than it was when I was kind of exploring that. So I just got lucky. I was at the right place at the right time. I was able to. Like you had mentioned, I worked for Atlanta for 28 years, and I just met some incredible people that gave me opportunities, and it just kind of went from there.
What do you feel your future is with the Wahoos?
I hope it's for a long time.
Is this a stepping stone to get back into Atlanta, or
no.
Do you like Pensacola?
How do you not like white sandy beaches? My front yard is the Gulf of Mexico.
That's right. You live on a beach, don't you?
Yeah, I do, and I don't have to mow a lawn or anything. Yeah. So it's spectacular. What a wonderful place. It's nice how people embrace you. I'm an outside guy, and my history is littered from coast to coast, and they have embraced me and the values that we stand for and everything. I think that they have, understand that. It's easier for me than some people because I'm really in the public eye a lot because of what I do. But also that can at times be a bit of a deterrent. Mm-hmm. It's easy for me. And I just, there's nothing not to like about Pensacola, I guess is what I'm saying.
I was here when I was real young.
I really like Frontier Motors a lot.
Well, I like that.
Now, can I start talking about some of the other auto dealerships?
Especially the ones that sponsor you. And, one of the things that I always talk
about.
Spend
a lot of money.
I always talk about Hill Kelly Dodge is one of them. They sponsor.
Boy.
Hill Kelly Dodge sponsors. They spend a lot of money sponsoring the
everything models. in the community.
They do a really good job. And we always talk about, when we talk about other car dealerships, I never say anything negative about car dealerships because obviously I've got to work with them. The last time we counted, Bruce, there was 106 car dealerships in Pensacola. I'm not sure if you know that statistic because you probably are a statistic kind of guy based on the fact you're in the ball business. But 106 car dealerships, there's 23 new car dealerships. And I always urge everybody that if you're going to buy a brand new car, patronize the local dealerships. If we're talking about Dodge or Jeep or Chrysler, Hill Kelly Dodge is our local dealer. So I would say that obviously we're the competition, but we only sell used cars. We don't sell new cars. So if you're going to buy a brand new Dodge truck, for example, we always urge you to go to Hill Kelly. And I think Kia also does some sponsorship.
Yeah, Sandy Sansing.
Sandy Sansing does a Kia.
All of them are no different than you. They're all very, very nice and very supportive partners.
Yeah, and I really always talk about that if you're going to be buying a vehicle brand new. For us to stay in business, somebody's got a brand new car. People always think, we get mad if I buy a new car. I said, I won't get mad.
Just bring it over to me when you get through.
Just as long as I get it. Because if somebody doesn't buy the brand new car, Frontier Motors is out of business. Because we don't. Now, we do have some cars in stock that have very low miles. We sold the Sentra the other day. It had 53 miles on it. So when you think about, us being a used car dealer, last time I counted, we had about 100 cars under 15,000 miles. That's a lot of low mileage cars. So we are the alternative to the new one. But I always say if you're going to buy a new one, we have customers come in to get a value for their trade-in because they're going to go to Hill Kelly and buy a brand new Wrangler, for example. So where we come in is we help them with the appraisal on their vehicle so that if for whatever reason the dealership you're dealing with, if they're not excited about the trade-in, then they sell it to us and they still go buy the brand new car. So I think it works good. It works really good for everybody involved.
Good stuff. Thank you for doing that.
It is good stuff.
And, can we talk about Pepsi now, too? Because they're a sponsor.
No, we're not talking about Pepsi. They have nothing.
I like this guy.
Well, we did talk about, one of the
Remember, things, I have two boys in college. Mm-hmm. I need to do all I can.
What is going on with the stadium naming rights? Years ago, somebody approached me. This is before you guys were even a business, and they talked about that you could actually buy. One of your sales reps came into Frontier Motors, and it was a certain. I'm not going to mention the dollar amount or anything because it was way over my particular budget. But they said that you could actually buy the naming rights to the stadium. It could be called Frontier Motors Wahoo Stadium or whatever, or Maritime Park.
Still can.
Can you really?
Oh.
How much is it? Come on.
On you and every car on your lot for the next 20 years can be the proud owner.
I wonder if you really get a return on that. You got to really divide.
Absolutely. It's amazing.
Of course.
You going to ask me something?
A stupid question. Absolutely.
It sure was.
But if I remember right, I thought it was for life, and I just heard it was like a 10-year program. Is that correct?
They are. I've seen them for 99 years. I've seen them for 5 years. It's across the board. A lot of times it's tied into the lease, the ball club,
gotcha.
With the the landowner, CMPA, and the city, in our case. But it varying degrees of pricing. I think that SunTrust just paid, $500 million for the naming rights for the new Atlanta Braves Stadium. I know that's kind of small numbers for you, but... I'm down there, Joseph. But that's a 99-year agreement. So spread that over 99 years, and it becomes affordable. Now, there's more than just, doesn't my name look nice up there? Because there's an awful lot of marketing opportunities that go with that.
Yeah, and I realize that even just things like the
you'd have to sell your boat.
Yeah, I would. What boat? We're not talking about boat. Actually, when we talk about Pensacola, one of the reasons I moved here is because of boating.
Yeah.
I was a boater in Wisconsin when I lived up there, and I moved down here. And once I got in the
boat. How was it getting the boat out of the ice in Wisconsin?
It was tough. It was awful. As a matter of fact, I mean, there's lots of stories we can get into, but we've only got about 5 minutes left. So one of the questions that I also had that we talked about at the last Wahoos game that I was at is I had some people from out of town, and we were talking about the players, you know, the question was, where do they live? How long are they around? What's the average time that the player spends in Pensacola before moving on, before getting either transferred, fired, whatever? That was a couple of the questions.
That's subjective. Mm-hmm. It really depends on availability of spots above them in the positions that they play. Mm-hmm. It depends on their progression and how they are adapting. Coming from Class A baseball to Double A Pensacola is a huge leap. You know, kids throw the ball a little bit harder, a little bit finer. They throw strikes more. They don't make as many mistakes. They hit the ball farther. They catch the ball better. They run faster. It is just an evolutionary process through that maturation steps of baseball. And so the same thing happens in AAA. Some kids, even though a lot of people think that a lot of players go from AA to the big leagues, that's not true, but it is. It's really highlighted when a kid does make that big leap. AAA baseball is tough, very, very tough. Yeah, varying ages. AA baseball, everybody's about the same age, anywhere from 19 to 24, something like that. So a kid, if he's here for a season, he's here for 6 months. Now, let me also tell you, the difference between, other than a paycheck, between the big leagues and the minor leagues is, a big league ball player gets paid on a 12-month cycle. A minor league baseball player gets paid on either a 3 or a 6-month cycle. So these kids, you know, at the AA level, they're making $2,500 to $3,500 on an average. Some will be more. Only get paid for 6 months, max.
$2,500
to $3,500
a month?
Yeah.
Okay.
So
they can pay the bills. They can.
Yeah. Now, the housing part is that it gets easier the longer the ball club is here because a lot of kids, well, here's the number, call these people and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And then we have some host families, kids will, 3 to 4 guys will get an apartment or something like that. But it's difficult to find an apartment for 6 months, especially when somebody can get called up or they get hurt or they get released or whatever it might be. So there is some difficulties with that. And then this is a tourist destination area, so there's not a lot of places available for the kids. Mm-hmm. Our fans have, and more than just our fans, the community has stepped up and really looked after the kids and found them, good quality places where, you know, I've got an extra bedroom or I've got an apartment attached to the house and you can have it and all that kind of stuff.
One of my friends, John Peacock, I remember him telling me that when you guys first started, he had a couple of the guys with him, which I thought, boy,
yeah.
I don't know if I could do that because I'm a very private guy, but here he is opening his house to players, you know. That's
yeah, a 22-year-old kid from Venezuela or Phoenix that you don't know anything about.
Now, since you guys started, I know the first year you had a phenomenal year because I think you got a lot of guys that got called up the majors, including Billy Hamilton. But
Tony Cigrani.
How many people have you had be called up since you guys have been there?
I think it's 7 so far.
Is that good? I mean, how is that ranked with other?
Oh, holy sakes, it's phenomenal. You know, what happens is that people gauge your talent based on wins and losses, and that's not the case. And we don't sell wins and losses. We sell the experience. We sell looking at these young kids. You know, we had a kid for parts of 2 years named Donald Lutz, who's in AAA now, but he's on the major league roster. Donald is an anomaly. He's from Germany. There's no German kids playing professional baseball that had made it to the big leagues. Billy Hamilton is just one of those. You know, he broke Vince Coleman's record that stood for 35 years, I think it was.
That was a big deal. That was a big deal.
Oh. And then we had Daniel Corsino that threw a no-hitter with the help of a relief pitcher who threw one inning. And on and on and on and on.
It's so
cool there's
to see.
A lot of different stuff like that.
It was so cool to see you guys on SportsCenter, Pensacola on SportsCenter.
Oh, my goodness. The starting shortstop for the New York Yankees now is Didi Gregorius. And where did he start? right here.
Yeah, I was watching myself. What a treat! And I'm hoping that this year we're going to get some plays. I know we haven't had the greatest start, but like you had mentioned before, you know, one of the things that I asked Bruce before we had the show, I says, what happens when you're not winning? Does it really affect the amount of people that come out to the ball game? He says it really depends, because I haven't seen it. Even last year, when we had a string of bad luck, the stadium was still packed.
We drew better last year than we did in year two.
Yeah, and yet not as good of a record.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's all cyclical. It is. It's about the kids. You know, last year we had four or five great starting pitchers and really no bullpen, but we had a setup guy and a closer. So if we can get to them, we're going to do pretty good. And then halfway through the season, we got some young kids, third baseman, couple outfielders, first baseman, that are very good. That's the unique part of minor league baseball. You're going to get anywhere from one to five kids. I mentioned earlier, I had a team with that played for us for 2 years. Vinny Castilla at third base, who later went on, was traded to the Colorado Rockies, and he had 50 home runs a year for like 5 years. Chipper Jones was my shortstop. Mark Lemke was second baseman. Ryan Klesko at first base. Javier Lopez and Eddie Perez behind the plate, and a kid named Tony Tarasco in right field, Essex Sneed in center field, and Mike Adams. Now, people may not have known who Essex Sneed and Mike Adams were. Mike Adams was number one draft pick for the Braves out of Arizona State. But everybody else has heard of, if you're a Braves fan, Chipper Jones, Mark Lemke, Klesko, Javier Perez, and all that. Interestingly enough, out of all those kids, the first one that got caught up was our catcher, Javier Lopez.
Wow.
And then Chipper goes on to be an all-world third baseman forever. And he then becomes an anomaly because he stays with one team his entire career. You know. Plus, oh, by the way, I had Smoltz, Glavin, Avery, on and on and on. Wohlers ad infinitum.
Too bad you don't get a little percentage of what they make every time you train someone and they get called up. They should give you like a 5% kickback for life.
I'm just happy to see the people mature. So they can go over to Frontier Motors and buy a used car with less than 25,000 miles on it.
Oh, that's perfect.
That originally came from either Sansing or Chevrolet or Hill Kelly.
That's right. That's one of the cool things about. No, you got it right. I think you got all your sponsors in there.
We've already talked about Pepsi. Yeah. I want to tell you, do you ever get hurt, loading these cars up?
I have people that do that for me.
What, get hurt or load cars up? Well, I was going to tell you, if you ever did, you had to go over to Andrews Institute.
I should know better. I saw their name on the scoreboard. What? I can't believe we forgot Andrews Institute.
And you live in town, so you watch Cox Cable.
Well, of course I do. I have Cox Cable.
And in the morning, I'm sure you watch Blab TV.
We can keep going until they shut us off here. We've only got a minute left. Again, this is the Frontier Motor Show. This has been a really treat doing something different than talking about cars, which we've been doing for 19 years. Frontier Motors, 230 Beverly Parkway. Our phone number is 436-8080. Thanks for listening. We got any minutes left, Grant, or are we done? Look, the music comes on.
About 30 seconds. Yeah, there's the music.
We're fading into the background. Thanks so much, Bruce. I appreciate it.
I thank you so much.
Guess what? You're in luck. Frontier Motors is down the street. Got the best deals that can't be beat. Don't overpay, come in today. Doing business the old-fashioned way. Frontier, we've got the right price. Frontier, we'll treat you mighty nice. Frontier Motors, low overhead. Frontier.